You don't need this, right? I mean, is this on? Yeah, am I audible still? I want to address two questions. One is, how do you take a product, more like a prototype developed in academic institution, to industry, commercialize that? Number two, how academics and industry people can work together, which are essentially two sides of the same question. And I call that formula as a golden spiral formula. Now, the problem we're talking about is, of course, demographic, dividend, what they say, or if you don't have jobs for deep taking, it's a disaster, you know that, right? But if you look at the numbers, the gap between the jobs available and the number of... Isn't it on? You sure it's on?
Yeah.
...of jobs, we are really able to create and increase that. But if you look at the products, I mean, you look at any products, I mean, it's very difficult to find a made in India software product. We're in NASSCOM, so we're talking about software products here. Very difficult to find which is made in India and used all over the world in large numbers. That is IT1 for you, okay? But IT2, we do have enough of Indian talent, as our Prime Minister says. You want any problem fixed, we can do that. Except that this is like an emergency solution. It can't be scaled up. You type Indian Jugaad on Google and you'll find many, many more examples. The problem is IT3, which I call as, we do not know how to translate an innovation into business, okay? And classically, the problem is that in research institutes like IITs, IISc, universities, the government is very happy to give money to take an idea and make a proof of concept. On the other side, if you tell the industry, they would rather have a very successful product developed somewhere in the world, and they don't mind putting warehouses and distribution network and branding to do that. But the moment you say, hey, can you take my idea from developed in an academic institute to all the way to industry, industry says, boss, that is highly risky. I can't do that. And the government, you ask them, can you give us money to take it to industry? They say, no, this is public money. You can't spend it on private enterprise. So there's a huge, huge valley of death in taking ideas from government, from academic institutes into private. The only way to do is to all the three to work together. But here is one more caveat. Usually scientists, and I represent the scientist group here, we think that when you do a piece of research, 80% of the value is done. And 30% is to make sure it meets all the standards, and 10% is to sell it. It took me several years to realize the equation is the other way around. What you do in lab and research is only 10% of the value, 30% is making it robust, meets all the standards and tested and all that. 60% to build the distribution network, your brand and channels and all those things. So I do tell my students, please, let's have a lot of respect for salespeople, marketing and salespeople. But here is my other thing, the first 5 minutes I told you, this is my last equation. After that, a lot of stories, which I'm going to cut down to half the numbers, but what I realized literally a few months back, if you look at the four axes, knowledge and products on x-axis, creation and transmission on the other axis, we get four quadrants, okay? So knowledge creation is research, product creation is development, knowledge transmission is education, product transmission is, you can say, business, industry, application, whatever. You can map our institutions along these four quadrants. I'm not going to details, but you can take a quick look. So IASC is like a kind of like a considered to be pure research. Whatever Professor Navkant Bhatt said, and I'm going to say that, people like him and I are actually in a minority. I would even put the number of scientists in IITs and IISCs who are doing translation research as maybe less than 10%, definitely maybe less than 2% actually, okay? So we are still research organizations. The issue I want to say is that we have this huge divide. We think that where Saraswati is there, Lakshmi cannot be there, and where Lakshmi is there, Saraswati cannot be there, okay? In fact, last three events where I inaugurated and we light the lamps, I'm beginning to say, why can't you put Lakshmi photo also along with Saraswati when you inaugurate those events, right? We need to have symbolic meeting of the two sides, okay? Now, so if you look at, go back to these four sides, research, development, education, application, and you go back to academic institutions, we can divide our professors and faculty in four categories. There's one group who loves to teach. They say, please do not promote us on the basis of publications. There's one group who loves to do research, but not teaching. There's one group who actually wants to go into villages and society and help them, but not do, let's say, cutting edge research. And then, you know. So the problem is these four corners. How do you connect them together? So I have this golden, what I call as golden sphere. I tell my colleagues and many other teachers, I told this now about 2,900 teachers. If there are a few, we're almost reaching 3,000 now. I tell our professors, faculty, scientists, go out of your classroom and offices and laboratories, go to real world. In a sense, I'm reflecting what Dr. Jagdish said just before that. Go to real world, see something. It could be a farm, it could be a factory, it could be a hotel or a hospital. Go something, see how the farmer is seeding the field. And next time when you go to the class, tell the students, hey, yesterday I went to this hotel and they were making these chapatis and or whatever, you know, they had this problem. I tell the professor the advantage is at least the students know the prof is going to tell a story in the first 5 minutes, they'll come to class on time. Minimum side effect, okay? But invariably, it has never failed. Some student always gets up and says, why are they doing like this? Why can't they do like that? And you tell the student, let's try it out. Don't tell him it has been tried before, someone has patented it, it's too expensive, too difficult. Don't say all those native things even if you know that. Tell him, let's try that. Give him encouragement. Let him find out the problems. Maybe he'll find a different solution. And then that leads to a solution, a project. And next time you go to that farm or factory, you tell the guy, hey, my student tried something like that. Would you like to try it in your life? If it works, you have one more story. If it doesn't work, you still have one more story. And that's what we have been able to do year after year after year. So I had actually 6-7 stories, but I cut it down in the last few minutes to just make 2 stories. One story is a software product. I actually like to claim this is the first developed in India by Indians, for Indians, of course for the world too, DeepTech software product, which is for 3-dimensional simulation of metal flow and solidification in a mold in a process called metal casting. Very difficult process. They call it a rocket science for rocket scientists. It is very complex. And it started all with my visiting foundries. I'm also a painter and photographer, so I used to love to see this. It's a highly energetic thing to see metal flowing into the molds. So I would take these photographs and start asking the questions. Eventually I realized they have lots of problems. Up to 25% rejections. It's huge, it's horrible. In a day when you talk about PPM rejections or Six Sigma quality, 25% rejection is huge, okay? I realized it is a multi-physics problem. And I realized that you need to build tools to solve the problem. So as a student at IISc, this is me, IISc Bangalore, 30 years back, 86, okay? All right. So I started developing perhaps India's first 3D software for simulating metal flow and solidification and finding defects. At that point, there was no scheme of any way to commercialize that. So IISc could not commercialize with me as a student. When I joined IIT Bombay, I found a brilliant student and an industry partner. It was very hush-hush, under the radar, because at that point, doing anything with industry was considered sin. Teachers supposed to do teaching, not doing a business or a product development. It's too early days, I'm talking about 25 years back. But I could manage to find loopholes and thing. We got an order from Ford Motor Company. How do we execute the order? So I had a conference in USA. So I go to the conference, tell my IIT that, okay, I'm going for this, but find a time, a couple of days to go to Ford Dearborn, install software, train the people, and get the job done, okay? But later on, I could slowly raise a group of students at IIT Bombay, brilliant students. I started with initially Pascal, then C, then C++, then C#. Eventually, we could do it in C#. And those students helped me to develop a proper, complete, end-to-end solution, design, simulation, and optimization. Then we got tied up with another lab called CSIR, NIST lab in Trivandrum. They all had developed a competing software, but not able to sell it. And it was nice points between the two, so I got them together. By the time IIT Bombay's ecosystem had taken off, so we could start a company called 3D Foundry Tech and actually launch it in World Foundry Congress and Indian Foundry Congress in 2012 in Chennai. Today, if you ask me, we have an end-to-end solution. We have almost like 100 plus organizations, 200 plus licenses. I know, 25% market share. We're competing with Germans and Americans and Koreans and Japanese and everyone else, okay? But it's a 25-year journey. It's a long journey. It's not viable for most people in the country. I was getting my salary from IIT Bombay, so I could do it on the part-time, right? It's not the way to do it. But one additional thing I want to mention is, I also was talking about there are 5,000 foundries in the country. Out of them only, I'm able to reach out to, let's say, 500, 10%. What about the 90% who are not able to afford the software? For them, we carried the world's first cloud-based simulation tool. I'm not going into details, but you can just Google eFoundry later. Today, we have like 70,000 visitors on that, 10,000, 5,000 plus members, and more than 10,000 odd simulations done on the thing. It does more simulation in one day than what the whole country does in 1 year. So it's like democratizing the tools and it's completely free. So I see people from Brazil and New Zealand, all kinds of countries using this tool. Again, this is one example of something excellent. People can't believe in USA and Japan that we could do something like this sitting in India. End of story one. Story two, I'm switching completely gears. This is medical domain, okay? About 2004, February, I was invited to see a surgery. That's just to prove that I was in the operating theater, okay? I'm a mechanical engineer, and I now you know I do a little bit of software on the side, but this is a different domain. And the doctor was doing a surgery on a 12-year-old boy who had a bone cancer in the other knee joint. And so amputating the leg, he would open the leg, as you can see in this picture, and they would remove the part of the bone along with the knee joint and replace with a mechanical joint. It's called as a mega knee prosthesis. The problem was this was costing about 5 lakh rupees just for the joint, not counting surgery, chemotherapy, and all those things, okay? So doctor said, can we not do it for about 20%, one-fifth of the cost? So over a period of 5 years, about six, seven, we started, 2010, 11, we finished, we developed a joint which was geared for Indian population's anatomy and functionality, and at almost one-tenth the cost of that manufacturing cost. Not only that, we could rope in a manufacturer, and now government has given money to even set up a manufacturing plant. So entire thing is funded by government. The research, which was initially 5 crores, the manufacturing plant is about 15 crore rupees, 20 crore rupees funded by the government, and that's how we could see it from research to reality in this domain. That is again one example. Then the government of Maharashtra came to me and said, okay, you did one device in 5 years, can you scale it up by 10 times? Can you do 5 devices per year? And that needed a bit of a thought. And I realized that, hey, there is an opportunity, and I'm trying to put it in a slide here. If you look at it, medical devices in India today, okay, imported ones are extremely expensive. Our market is about $5 billion, about 35,000 crores. We import about 70% of it. It's a huge amount of outgo of foreign exchange. I realize that those devices are not necessarily suitable for our requirements, our anatomy, our functionality, the number of surgeries done. So they have to be suitable, they have to be affordable, but sometimes it doesn't mean cheaper. Sometimes the device have to be more robust than the imported ones because of the conditions or repetitive use that we do. And on the other hand, if you see, it is a golden opportunity. The kind of the paradigm shift which is happening in medical device, thanks to medical imaging, thanks to mobile phone, which is like a beautiful platform with at least a dozen sensors built into that, and 3D printing and CAD CAM, it is possible to reinvent the whole thing and leapfrog and quantum jump into the whole thing. But we need to put all these people together. More importantly, we need what's called as a knowledge integrators, people who can connect all the dots to get a device out into the thing. Now I say that electronic software, India has a forte, so we have to get into this domain. We have this window of about, I would say 2 to 5 years, and Bangalore perhaps is a very good place for this ecosystem to develop. Now what we did was, when the government of Maharashtra came to us, they gave us 40 crores, and what we did is, we connected the 4 stakeholders. It's just a slide, I'm not going to go in details, but on the top your government, on the left your hospitals, where you pick up the problem, give a solution. On the right side, whatever little industry is there, we entice them to get into this medical domain. And the bottom, your academia. Instead of building one big fort in IIT Bombay, we are having networks, hub and spoke model set up where we have only 5-6 institutions linked up, left bottom, which you see in that. Okay, and we have a proper system of training them. These are our lab at IIT Bombay and a similar labs in other places. So we have idea room, which is all, I tell them a happy room actually. One whole wall is full of junk, plastic and paper and tubes and wires and all that. They sit and build those POCs first, then they go to CAD CAM, then they go to 3D printing prototyping, we have electronics prototyping also, and then finally testing and so on. And we have doctors and doctors and doctors. We are so incredibly lucky. When people from Stanford Biodesign and MIT and Harvard and Johns Hopkins come to our lab, one question they definitely ask is, sir, how do you get in touch with doctors? I ask them, how do you get in touch with doctors? They say, sir, we send an email, then we make a phone call, then we visit them, and usually say, come back next week, as if we are sales representatives. I tell them, we have a reverse problem. We have so many doctors knocking on doors. We tell them, sorry, I can't get an appointment now. Can you come back next week or next month? Every day on average, either there's a doctor in our lab or we are in a hospital. We are increasingly getting into hospitals, into operating theaters. And I'm very proud to say we are working with the best people in the country, best cardiologists, best neurologists, best orthopedic, dental, you name it. And we are agnostic to domain. We work with every domain in medical domain. Of course, we have lab, we have all the people. So when a doctor comes and says, starts throwing a jargon, I look around the room and say, hey, did you understand that? Ah, biomedical, biomechanics, I have medical people in my lab. So if someone understands, say, okay, go ahead. Language is a big issue between engineers and doctors. Okay, this is another important slide. in a sense, Stanford Biodesign is kind of put a stamp on everything that happens in the world. So I'm keen to say that we have our BETIC model, but the basics are same. You have to start with, the first step is always in the medical domain. You have to go to hospitals, do what's called a clinical immersion. And this whole process is about 1 year process, 3 months each. We spend up to 3 months just understanding the problem and trying to come with a one-line statement of what the problem we are trying to solve. And then you have develop, which is engineer, researcher. That game we know very well. But third phase, usually in academic institution, it stops here. We want to go beyond that. Testing is where students lose a patient. Students are not good for taking it to the next stage. You need a full-time researchers sitting on machines to do testing, clinical trials, and so on. All the yellows, if you're noticing, that is where the clinician plays a very important role. So when a doctor comes and says, this is a very important problem, you solve it. The next question I ask is, so sir, will you meet us every week? Will you give us 1 hour every week? Without that, it's not going to work out. And then we have the business model, which is IPR and make a business plan and all those things. Now the trick is the ratio of success. You start with 100 ideas, you may end up with about 12. Actually, you know, ratio is 1:10 in every stage. But if a day 1:10, no student will come and work with me to start with. So I say 1:2, okay, that's better. But also I'm saying that if you follow a scientific methodology of doing that, I think we can be getting there. And I can show you with numbers at the last slide that we are getting there. So here are just some of the devices we developed in the last couple of years. These are all surgical devices. I actually have a story of these. Everyone has a long, beautiful story. So this is first one, for example, is a for laparoscopic surgeons. They say when I go there and I want to do a cut, I want an additional movement so I can also turn my instrument around. So you need an additional degree of freedom in laparoscopy. And second one is for cardiology, there's for endotracheal is for gallbladder surgery and all kinds of things. Biopsy gun, you can see everything is new, everything is patented. Similarly, we are doing a lot of diagnostic and screening devices. Cardiac auscultation already is gone into the field where you're putting into what's called the health ATMs. Again, a long, beautiful story. Many of these are developed by people who have left their jobs. So the auscultation is done by two engineers. One of them in Intel, one was in L&T, and they both gave up their jobs and they joined the lab and they took a big salary cut, almost half the salary they're taking now, and they're doing it forward. The last bunch of things is rehab and 3D printing devices. Again, each one is a beautiful story. I'll pick up just one story because it's NASSCOM, and it's only one I want to talk about, a software product. The doctor said that, can you develop a software to convert a two-dimensional X-ray picture into a three-dimensional model which can be 3D printed? I first laughed at him and told him, sir, it's not possible, because if you can do that, you can be a multi-billionaire, because there's so many drawings in all over the world which need to be converted into legacy drawings which need to be converted into three dimensions. The doctor laughed back at me saying that, hey, when I put X-ray on my illuminator, I can imagine the shape in my 3D, so why can't you put all this artificial intelligence to talk about and make a 3D model by putting knowledge, domain knowledge into that? So I kind of went back and thought about it and put a student onto working on that. And he actually worked on it for 3 years. So I also take the word that any deep technology needs at least one or two generations of PhD, so true about it. So this boy who eventually developed a software for converting, algorithm converting 2D to 3D, X-ray, single X-ray, and the accuracy is almost there. If you take a CT image, which is like 200, 300 images, and you put it together to make a 3D image, the accuracy of that is about, error of that from a real life actual shape is about 0.5 millimeter. This error is about 0.8 millimeters, so not too bad in a medical domain, okay, almost there. And this boy went ahead and of course filed a patent, started a company, he has a picture with Prime Minister, the President, the Health Minister, S&T Minister, everything else. There's also a Facebook joke, I'm not going to, okay, but there's a detailed joke, the joke itself is a long one, I'll cut that out, okay. But we're also creating platforms for these innovators to actually exhibit. And we actually take them all the way to the edge of commercialization. So we not only get them to make their developed devices, functional prototypes, pilot manufacturing, patenting, including PCT filing, and exhibitions, and attorneys, everything we take care. I tell them, everything you do will take care of the cost until you have the first customer saying, can I buy that? And puts a check on the table, then you start a company. Too many young people, I'm so sorry to say, too many young people are so keen to make a visiting card and write vice president of, or founder of such and such company, and they're struggling for next 3 years developing and raising money. It's so foolish to do that. I tell them, you do everything when you're ready for receiving the first check from the first customer, then you start a company. So just to summarize, I thought I saved enough time. We could create an ecosystem of people and facilities and experts in the room. We could create a process by which we could take an idea from a doctor, unmet clinical need, what we call as bed to bench to bed, and products and promotion kind of a thing, and look at the numbers. Since January 2015, this whole thing started in 2015, January, we have done about 140 medical devices, okay? I'm talking about ideas where there is a proof of concept, there's actual working proof of concept for 140 medical devices. We have filed 22, 23 patents, I think, as of today. And we have done 5 tech transfer. Again, 2 or 3 are on the discussion table as we speak at this point of time. I do not think anywhere in the world this kind of numbers existed. Or so far, I don't see hear that. So something we got it right. Something is working here. And I try to put that in a slide for you to see whether you can do that. So maybe the first thing I share with you is that one is you need excellent facilities. You need really good facilities for prototyping and testing under one roof. You cannot be running. When we initially started, this boy used to run to Vasai, which is like 2.5 hours by train from IIT Powai to Vasai, because he's a manufacturer which can do the kind of precision manufacturing. He went 60 times, 5 hours per day. That's enormous amount of time and effort wasted for a researcher who wants to focus on product development. So you need everything under one roof, number one, including the operators. You can't just buy the, buying machines is easy, but getting an operator to run a 5-axis CNC machine is not easy to get. So you need everyone in the room. Second is the people, okay? Now you need people who are multidisciplinary. You need people who are coming to the lab. I get patent lawyers coming, I get painters and poets coming to the lab, I get bioscientists coming to the lab. I get as variety as possible. I see it's always better because collision between different disciplines is what creates creativity and beautiful ideas. And third is, of course, the culture, where Indians have to, it's like mental game, it's like a mental battle, okay? One thing I tell my team is, we are not creating a device, we are making a difference. We are showing to the country that, yes, Indians can work together in a team, okay, and take the whole thing forward. And I tell them, focus on delivery. Don't just think about that I'll file a paper or a patent. I tell them, put a face of the patient. Think that this device is going to help this particular patient, okay? Put a face to everything. Focus on delivery to the end patient. In fact, my metric is how many devices are in the hospital and how many patients we have touched with our devices. That's the metric really I'm talking about. But also teamwork and fail quickly. Many people and many researchers, many scientists I have met, I'd ask them, so did you show it to any doctor? They say, no, we are working for the last 5 years and it's not perfect yet. I said, 5 years of working on it, you're not shown to any doctor? How do you know it's going to be useful or you're solving the right problem? So I tell people, try to fail tomorrow if possible, or next week at the most, or next month, not fail next year. Fail quickly, get up quickly, ask people a lot of questions, feed the feedback cycles, hundreds of them. So anyone fails, we celebrate, we cut a cake, as long as they're failing in a different way, not the same way, that is foolish. And all these ingredients cooked in the fire of projects makes very, very beautiful results, okay? So I stop with that. Sorry I rushed a little bit because I was anxious that I didn't want to hold you up for your lunch. But you can Google these two, eFoundry and Betic, and I hope that what I shared with you will take it forward. We definitely need hundreds of centers like that. We are already linking up with almost 20 odd centers all over the country in various IITs, various other institutions, private funding agencies also. But we need to share our best practices and ideas and bring the whole team collectively up. Thanks to the kind of platforms that we are in now, we have a fairly good say in the government these days. I mean, all the way to secretary level and policymakers and Niti Aayog and all that. So as you said, I wish we had saved enough time for discussions and ideas here. But even if you feel like that, please do mail to the organizers, or for me, it's, if you remember my name, Prof. B. Ravi, you can just Google and you'll get my contacts. You can write to me, but I would assure you that any good ideas will take it forward all the way to the government levels and try to get the ecosystem going in a much more stronger way. But thank you very much for listening to me.